Hello and a very good evening. You're watching the news at 6 on Rajya Sabha Television with me, Frank Pereira. Here are the headlines. Election Commission asks officials in poll-bound states to cover up photographs of political leaders on hoardings and advertisements. Only government hoardings conveying social messages to be displayed. Both factions of Samajwadi Party asked to submit their case for party symbol on January 13th in a fresh sign of attempts for truce. Akhilesh meets his father Mulayam Singh in Lucknow. Income tax department claims about 3 to 4 lakh crore rupees of evaded income has been deposited into banks since November 9th, focus on 60 lakh accounts, deposits in Northeast and cooperative banks. And just hours after Pakistan says it launched its first submarine-launched cruise missile, Babur 3, analysts poke holes in its claims. Technical evidence suggests military used computer graphics to weapons flight. The Election Commission has asked officials in the five poll-bound states to either cover or remove photographs of political leaders on all hoardings and advertisements. It said that hoardings and advertisements that seek to project achievements of any living political functionary or political party should be removed immediately. However, it made it clear that government hoardings that convey a general message to the masses on family planning or social welfare schemes may be allowed to be displayed. The poll panel made it clear that no political party or functionary can use public resources and incur or authorize expenditure from public exchequer to promote any political leader's image. It further said that such images or hoardings undoubtedly amount to their individual or party election campaign at public cost. Five states are going to polls between February 4th and March 8th. They include Uttar Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Punjab, Goa and Manipur. The model code of conduct came into force on January 4th when the schedule was announced. Well, the Election Commission has asked both factions of the Samajwadi Party to appear before it on January 13th. It will hear arguments from both sides before deciding who gets the cycle symbol of the party. Mulayam Singh has already told the media that the party stands united for the benefit of the state. He also asserted that the party will soon begin the campaign, while claiming that Akhilesh will be the next chief minister. In a fresh development indicating a movement towards a patch-up within the Samajwadi Party, Uttar Pradesh Chief Minister Akhilesh Yadav today met his father Mulayam Singh Yadav. The 90-minute meeting comes just a day after Mulayam declared Akhilesh as the chief ministerial candidate of the party. In the wake of the power struggle within the party, Mulayam had refused to project Akhilesh as the Samajwadi Party chief ministerial candidate. He had insisted that he will decide who will be the chief minister if the Samajwadi Party came back to power in the state. Party insiders said that Akhilesh's uncle Shivpal Yadav and Rajya Sabha member Amar Singh were not present at today's meeting. This was also in contrast to a similar meeting between father and son last week that failed to end the stalemate in the party. In fact, the meeting was followed by a vertical split, with the chief minister's faction declaring Akhilesh the party president in place of Mulayam. Akhilesh's rebellion against his father veers around a demand that Shivpal and Amar Singh should be removed from the decision-making process. And joining me for a chat right now, live from Lucknow, is our correspondent Kriti Mishra. Kriti, quite a few developments taken place within the Samajwadi Party in Lucknow today, the latest, of course, being the meeting between the father-son duo, which lasted for 90 minutes.
Well, that's right, Frank. Speculation was rife today that the duo would come ahead and address a joint press conference, but that clearly didn't happen. Now, party insiders and confidants of Chief Minister are telling us that apparently Mulayam had asked Akhilesh to withdraw the letter that he has given in the Election Commission. He also assured Akhilesh that if party wins, then he would be the party's chief ministerial candidate. On the other hand, Mulayam asserted that he wishes to continue to be the party president. Now, Akhilesh has been reiterating for months now that he only wants to be the party president only for 3 months so that he could emerge victorious and he could present this victory on his father's feet. So the confusion over the probable patch-up or break-up in the Samajwadi Party prevails. Frank?
Well, in the previous such meeting, we saw that, you know, Shivpal Yadav and Amar Singh too were present, but that wasn't the case this time around. And we understand that both the confidants of Mulayam Singh Yadav, of course, were not present for this meeting.
Well, that's right, Frank. In fact, that's why this meeting was extremely crucial after days of stalemate between the warring factions of the Samajwadi Party. Because Shivpal and Amar Singh, both that the CM has problems with, they both of them were absent from this meeting. So this was one-on-one between the estranged father and the son. But again, a truce was expected, but it wasn't declared. And in fact, party insiders are again telling us that the chief minister has asked his supporters to prepare for elections. Frank?
Kriti, one of the demands from Akhilesh Yadav was the fact that he did not want Shivpal and Amar Singh, especially within the party, or Shivpal to have any kind of decision-making powers. Has he put forth some of those demands, or do we have any idea as to what transpired between the father-son duo at today's meeting?
Well, the nitty-gritties, we are unaware about the nitty-gritties and actually what transpired. But party insiders are saying that, in fact, Mulayam has been cajoling Akhilesh that they should fight together. He should withdraw the letter from Election Commission. And also that Mulayam asserted that he wants to continue to be the party president. But Akhilesh also has been very vociferous with his demands. He wants breathing space in Lucknow, and he's been very categorical about this demand that as far as the ticket distribution is concerned, he wants complete control, autonomy and authority over the ticket distribution. But any truce right now, we are not aware of it, and it wasn't, of course, declared. So it remains to be seen whether the Samajwadi Party splits or they fight together and put up a united front.
While all this is happening, of course, Kriti, there is the other issue of, the election symbol as such. Now, what's the latest as far as the symbol itself is concerned? When can we see the Election Commission taking a decision on that?
Well, 13th January, that's Friday, the Election Commission would decide. In fact, they have also sent out a letter to the warring factions of the Samajwadi Party. So all eyes are set on the Election Commission's decision, whether they freeze the symbol, which is the cycle, whether they give it to Akhilesh's camp or whether they give it to Mulayam Singh Yadav. Frank?
All right, Kriti Mishra, we'll have to leave to that. Thank you so much for joining us there with those details and bringing us up to date with the latest. Going on now, ahead of the assembly polls, we also take a close look at constituencies of the state. Lucknow district houses 9 assembly constituencies in Uttar Pradesh. Lucknow city is among the top 15 cities of India by GDP growth. Ranked 6th in a list of the 10 fastest growing job creating cities in India, Lucknow has emerged as an important center of governance, administration, education and commerce.
Lucknow. Uttar Pradesh capital was once known as the Awadh region. The city of Nawabs or the city of Tehzeeb is today the administrative headquarters of Lucknow district and Lucknow division. The melting pot of cultures has beckoned visitors for ages with its Lucknowi kebabs and biryani. Home to extraordinary monuments that are fascinating blend of ancient, colonial and oriental architecture, Lucknow has been no less vibrant politically.
Lucknow's political nursery of UP, leaders like Chandrasekhar ji, Biswanath Pratap Singh ji, Mulayam Singh ji, and are active. They started their political career from Lucknow. And even C.V. Gupta, who's known as the founder of the Lucknow, he is the most of the senior politician, started his career from Lucknow. Even Lal ji Tandon, Rajnath Singh ji, representing constituency, Lok Sabha constituency of Lucknow, and a former Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee. They were all, started their political career here.
Voting in Lucknow district will be held in the third phase of 2017 assembly elections. Approximately 35 lakh residents will exercise their franchise on February 19th. Ahead of the crucial day, they are flagging issues of the development.
Employment ke liye hame bahar na jana pade.
Sarkar ko kuch aisa karna chahiye jisse traffic follow, traffic rule follow.
The 9 assembly constituencies of Lucknow are Malihabad, Bakshi Ka Talab, Sarojini Nagar, Lucknow West, Lucknow North, Lucknow East, Lucknow Central, Lucknow Cantonment and Mohanlal Ganj. Notification for the third phase will be issued on January 24th, with January 31st being the last date for nominations. Scrutiny of nominations will be done on February 2nd, while withdrawal of the candidature is on February 4th.
From infrastructure point of view, HR point of view, planning point of view, security point of view, from all directions, all sort of things, we have all done all preparations.
Currently, Lucknow East is represented by BJP's Ashutosh Tandon, while Lucknow Cantonment was held by former Congress UP Chief Rita Bahuguna Joshi, who later joined the BJP. The rest of the 7 assembly constituencies are held by the Samajwadi Party members.
Lucknow has been the political nursery of several political bigwigs. Electoral history shows that voters of this district have given chances to various candidates hailing from different political parties. However, if the MLAs did not meet the expectations, they were shown the exit door. Now again, Lucknow is all set to witness a fierce multi-cornered contest. Reporting from Lucknow, with camera person Shiv Kumar, I'm Kriti Mishra for Rajya Sabha Television.
Well, Delhi's Deputy Chief Minister Manish Sisodia today triggered a political buzz by indicating that Aam Aadmi Party convener Arvind Kejriwal may be the party's chief ministerial candidate in Punjab. Sisodia's statement triggered speculation in political circles as to whether Kejriwal was planning to shift to Punjab and quit Delhi once again. Sisodia told voters in Mohali to cast their vote, assuming that Kejriwal was the chief ministerial candidate, and vote for him. The Aam Aadmi Party, that won 4 Lok Sabha seats in 2014 Lok Sabha elections, was seen as a major alternative force to Congress and Akali Dal for the voters. Kejriwal had earlier ruled out contesting elections from Punjab. The assembly elections for 117 seats will be held in single phase on February 4th. The results of the elections will be announced on the 11th of March.
पंजाब तो यही मान के वोट करें कि अरविंद केजरीवाल को मुख्यमंत्री बनाने के लिए वोट दे रहे हैं. मैं इसलिए कहा कि जो भी वादे पूरे कर रहे हैं अरविंद केजरीवाल ऐसे नहीं भागेंगे. पंजाब के लिए जो जो वादे करें वो पूरे करवाएंगे. एक एक आदमी मुख्यमंत्री बनेगा, आम आदमी मुख्यमंत्री बनेगा. पंजाब का मुख्यमंत्री ऐसा होगा जो नशा नहीं फैलाएगा.
Well, income tax department officials claim that about 3 to 4 lakh crore rupees of evaded income has been deposited into banks. The deposits are being looked at as a result of demonetization of old 500 and 1000 rupee notes by the government. Over 60 lakh individual bank accounts saw a sum of more than 2 lakh rupees deposited since November 9th. Also under scrutiny is over 10,700 crore rupees in cash that was deposited in different bank accounts in northeastern states since November 9th. Enforcement Directorate officials will also examine deposits of over 16,000 crore rupees in cooperative bank accounts. The IT department claims that large sums of money had been deposited in these banks without documentation. It's time for a short break now, but news and updates will continue on the other side. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
You are still not seen as a heavyweight politician of the BJP.
I cannot be as effective as those people who have got 50 members or 30 members.
If you're not loud, you're not heard inside the assembly. You are not heard by the people.
Simply by shouting, the point is not driven home. The purpose of the reasoning, that is important.
People have already started saying that the party has not given you your due.
We have to bring in the younger people. The elder people will play their role.
Watch To The Point with the sole BJP legislator in Kerala Assembly, O Raja Gopal, only on Rajya Sabha Television.
One of the most influential revolutionaries of Indian freedom struggle, Shaheed Bhagat Singh. Born into a Sikh family, patriotism flowed in his blood at the age of 13. When he formed Naujawan Bharat Sabha to spread the message of revolution in Punjab. In the wake of avenging Lala Lajpat Rai's death, Bhagat Singh and his associates coined the catchphrase Inqilab Zindabad. But towards the end of their rebellion, they had to pay a heavy price for their patriotism. Following the blasts inside the corridors of the assembly, both Bhagat Singh and Batukeshwar Dutt courted arrest. Bhagat Singh was sent to the gallows in Lahore with his fellow comrades, after which he was cremated in Husainiwala on the banks of Satluj.
Welcome back. You're watching Rajya Sabha Television. Well, the 8th edition of the vibrant Gujarat Global Summit 2017 was inaugurated by Prime Minister Narendra Modi in Ahmedabad on Tuesday. Reliance Industries Chairman Mukesh Ambani and interim Chairman of Tata Group Ratan Tata were among the other dignitaries present. This time, the event is being held on a mega scale with many heads of states, top global and Indian CEOs and several business houses participating. The state government expects to receive investment proposals of more than 25 lakh rupees. I'm proud to say 25 lakh crore rupees at this year's summit. 12 nations are partner countries for the event, including USA, the UK, Australia, Japan and the UAE. Earlier, Prime Minister Modi met leaders of Japan, Rwanda, Denmark and Serbia on the sidelines of the investment summit. He had also opened the vibrant Gujarat Global Trade Show on Monday. The 8th Vibrant Gujarat Summit is focusing on sectors like sustainable development and establishing Gujarat as a business destination. Well, cold wave conditions further intensified in North India with a spell of moderate snowfall. Warning of a cold wave has been issued in the northwestern region. At least 21 trains are arriving late in Delhi, 9 rescheduled, 7 cancelled due to dense fog. A look at the cold wave conditions in several states now. Kargil in Kashmir recorded the coldest night of the season at minus 12.4 degrees Celsius, with the temperature at most places in Kashmir division going down below the freezing point. Leh was the coldest recorded place in Jammu and Kashmir as it registered a low of minus 13.9 degrees Celsius. According to the Meteorological Department, famous tourist spots of Gulmarg and Pahalgam were the only places in Kashmir division where the mercury marked improvement. The piercing cold wave sweeping most parts of Himachal Pradesh further aggravated today. Shimla, Kullu and Sirmur districts remain cut off from the rest of the state while vehicular traffic was badly disrupted due to slippery road conditions. The water pipes froze and burst at several places affecting water supply. A sum of 25 crore rupees has been released for restoration of essential commodities in the areas affected by heavy snowfall at the high-level meeting chaired by Chief Minister Veerbhadra Singh. Despite these, the tourists are making a beeline to Kufri and other surrounding areas to enjoy the snow. After weeks of moderate weather, icy winds hit Delhi, NCR, Punjab, Haryana, Rajasthan and many parts of Uttar Pradesh today. Minimum temperatures plunged to 4 degrees Celsius in many areas. The centre has issued precautionary warnings over the region till January 13th. It also said that the frost was likely to damage Rabi crops. Farmers have been told to irrigate their crops in the next 24 hours. Well, here's a roundup of the other national news and nationwide. Controversial BJP parliamentarian Sakshi Maharaj faced possible disciplinary action with the Election Commission issuing notice to him over his comments. He had earlier blamed the Muslim community for India's population growth. Sakshi Maharaj, who is the Lok Sabha MP from Unnao in Uttar Pradesh, has been asked to reply by Wednesday morning. The Maharashtravadi Gomantak Party, Goa Suraksha Manch and Shiv Sena today announced the formation of a grand alliance for the upcoming Goa Legislative Assembly elections. The alliance, which is contesting in all 35 out of the 40 seats in the Goa Assembly, has announced Sudhin as their chief ministerial face. According to the Border Security Force, a soldier who posted videos of poor food arrangements in the Jammu and Kashmir camp was court-martialed in 2010 because of indiscipline. However, he was allowed to stay on humanitarian grounds. BSF authorities have said that this was the first time any force personnel had resorted to social media for complaint. Within hours, the videos had gathered 2.6 million views and 165,000 shares. In other news now, experts have questioned Pakistani claims of successfully launching the nuclear-capable Babur III cruise missile, and using satellite imagery suggested that Islamabad may have faked the launch video. They also put out technical evidence to suggest that Pakistan had used computer graphics to depict much of the weapon's flight. Pakistan had claimed that Babur III missile is its first submarine-launched cruise missile. Pakistan military proudly claimed that the indigenously produced missile has a range of 450 kilometers and can carry a nuclear warhead. The country's military in a statement further said that the missile was fired from an underwater mobile platform and it hit its target with precise accuracy, and that it gives the country a credible second strike capability. Well, U.S. President-elect Donald Trump has named his son-in-law Jared Kushner as one of his senior White House advisors. The 35-year-old played a key role in the presidential campaign, and his new White House job will cover both domestic and foreign policy. Kushner, who is married to Ivanka Trump, is a property developer and has said that he would step down as boss of his family's real estate business if he took a White House job. Kushner will also not take a salary. However, his appointment will be controversial because of nepotism laws and concerns over potential conflicts. Trump's team has argued that a law barring officials from giving government jobs to relatives does not apply to White House positions. Well, here's a roundup of the other international news in World Wrap. The UN has said that 22,000 Rohingyas have fled Myanmar to Bangladesh in the past week, one-third of the number that fled since the army launched a crackdown in the north of Rakhine State. This implies a sharp escalation in the numbers fleeing a military campaign, which rights groups say has been marred by abuses so severe they could amount to crimes against humanity. The statement comes as UN's human rights envoy for Myanmar, Yang He Lee, began a 12-day visit to Myanmar. UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres on Tuesday will deliver his first address to the Security Council since taking office. In his speech, he is likely to make the case for a new, more assertive diplomacy backed by world powers. Guterres took over from Ban Ki-moon on January 1st with a pledge to shake up the world body and boost efforts to tackle global crises. At least 8 people have been killed in a suicide bomb attack on a police station in North Sinai, Egypt. The bomber rammed the building in El Aris with a lorry filled with explosives. Militants then opened fire on the police station. No group has yet taken responsibility for the attack, but the area is often targeted by Islamic State group. Well, more than 30 people are now known to have died as icy temperatures continue to grip much of Europe, many of them migrants or homeless people. 10 people died of cold in Poland on Sunday. Deaths have also been reported in Italy, the Czech Republic, Russia and Ukraine. Temperatures have plunged to below minus 20 degrees Celsius in some regions. Even Greece's islands are covered in snow. Well, Prime Minister Narendra Modi is addressing the gathering at the vibrant Gujarat summit. Let's listen in.
The initial partner countries of the vibrant Gujarat event, Japan and Canada. Many other prestigious global organizations and networks are also partners of this event. I thank you all of this partnership. Your presence is a source of motivation for business leaders as well as young entrepreneurs gathered here. Without your support, this event could not have seen 8 biennial chapters, each better and bigger than the earlier one. The last 3 events have been particularly big. The presence of political and business leaders from more than 100 countries and a large number of organizations from around the world make this a truly global event. I would urge the participants to reach out to each other and to derive the greatest benefit from this summit. You should also visit the trade show and the exhibition where hundreds of companies have showcased their products and processes. Gujarat, the land of Mahatma Gandhi and Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, also represents the business spirit of India. Through the ages, it had led in commerce and enterprise. Centuries ago, its people went across the 7 seas in search of opportunities. Even today, this state boasts of being the origin of the highest number of our people living and working abroad. And wherever they have gone, they have created a mini Gujarat.
Well, that's it on this edition of the newscast. Have a good evening.